Yo, what's up? It's Nick Cannon, and when I'm in Charlotte, I'm watching the Chocolate Box.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the next installment of the Chocolate Box Present. I'm your host, Nick Moore, standing in for the Chocolate Drop. Tonight joining us, we have a very special show tonight. We're going to be talking about Kershaw Prison, Paying It Forward. My special guest is the founder of an incredible organization, Proverbs 22:6, Brother Cyril Prabhu. Welcome tonight, sir.
Thank you.
Listen, I can't hardly believe that we've been working in the same prison for like 8 months and haven't run into each other.
Of course.
But I want to talk to you a little bit about Proverbs 22:6. Tell us a little bit about the organization.
Proverbs 22:6 is a verse from a Bible. It is from the book of Proverbs 22, verse 6. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it.
Wow.
And Proverbs 22:6 is an organization that works with the children whose parents are in prison. We work with the children in the college. We work with the children in school age, take them all the way through college, and we pay for their college.
Wow, that's pretty awesome. I don't want you to, and I'm not going to let you rush me tonight either.
Okay? Oh, sure.
Listen, man, why are you doing this? I mean, what transpired in your life that moved you to the point where you want to give back in this magnitude?
It probably started like 42 years ago when my mom was left on the streets of Chennai, which is in the southern part of India. My uncle gave me an opportunity to stay in his house, gave me food and a shelter.
Wow.
And I want to be the uncle for somebody else. And when I grew up, there was a lady from Australia, Annie, who sent every single month $35 dedicatedly. And because of her generosity, today I'm a senior vice president at Bank of America.
Wow.
And what rope that they gave it to me, I want to give it to somebody else.
Wow. So you're not talking about just extending the rope. You're talking about tying a knot in that rope.
Absolutely.
And pulling people along with you.
Absolutely.
And that's powerful. So I want to ask you, how do you got to this place, though? I mean, it's very easy for somebody to get to the point that you talk about,
right,
matriculating from India, coming here, working at one of the Fortune 500 companies, the largest companies in the world.
Right.
And decide, why prisons? I mean, of
right,
all places to go, why prison?
When I came into the country in 1993, one of the things that I wanted to do was buy a computer. Mm-hmm. So I went to buy a computer in San Leandro, California.
Wow.
And there, fortunately or unfortunately, I was taken down at a gunpoint. And I was locked up for like 45 minutes. And these guys were stealing the entire store, about $1 million worth of computers. And at the end of the event, at the end of that incident, I was very bitter, I was very angry, and I wanted to go back to India because when I came into this country, what I was expecting was like a milk and honey, and that wasn't the milk and honey that I was expecting, so I wanted to go back to India. And somehow, during that period of my bitterness, anger, and frustration, God turned my attention towards the guys who put me through that. And he helped me to forgive these guys. He gave this overwhelming feeling of affection towards their families.
Mm-hmm.
So what happened to me as I grew up, you know, with this event, just connected me back into working with the kids,
wow,
whose parents are in prison.
That's powerful. I think that when we talk about this difference between Proverbs 22:6, the scripture talks about raising up a child. You and I were talking earlier, and it really kind of struck me because in a minute we're going to cut to a video of an event that you did, a back-to-school event.
Mm-hmm.
And once we roll this video, I want you to talk a little bit about how that impacted you.
Absolutely.
But before we get to that, I have a specific question for you.
Absolutely.
Why Proverbs 22:6?
the book of Solomon, I mean, book of Proverbs, when Solomon wrote that book, you know, he is very specific about training the children. You know, he says, train up a child in the way he should go, not in the way his father went, not in the way his mother went. And that's what intrigued me when I saw these children. When I saw these children, I saw myself in them. Wow. Because when somebody asked me, like when I was in India, what is my father doing? I wouldn't have an answer for them. I always lie about it. Mm-hmm. And I saw the same thing in the kid whose parents are in prison. They cannot tell. My father is in the biggest prison in town. Wow. It just like it kills and crushes their soul.
It's almost an embarrassment, isn't it?
Absolutely.
And they create these fantasies.
Correct.
About, they even tell their kids, their friends, about what their father's doing. Like you said, they have no idea what their father's doing.
Absolutely. And they carry the stigma.
Yes. The interesting thing about the whole process for me is when you engage the people inside the prison, what type of response are you getting from the inmates?
We have about like 230 men that are now part of the program, and we have 650 children Wow. in this program. And what I told these men is very simple. I do not want your children to go through the same path you have gone. Wow. We want to stop these children from coming through the same gates you came through.
Wow.
I want to stop that bleeding from happening. Yeah, and these amazing. Men, that's how they got involved.
Yeah, that's a pretty, so how does the program work? I mean, how does that, tell us how it works.
Okay.
Mechanics of it.
We started with the Kershaw Correctional, right. And we go in there. I went in there and I spoke to the fathers and I told them about, you know, When a father comes into prison, the children ask four questions. Number one question, where are you, Dad? Because the children doesn't know where the fathers are.
Wow.
Because they can go into any place where they can find a bed. Yes. Number two, they want to know, are you safe, Dad? Mm. Because all they hear is this clamping sound. All they hear on TVs is this tattooed guys, you know, who are muscular and tall and macho. The children wants to make sure the father who is serving time in prison is safe.
Wow.
The third question is that they want to know, do you really love me, Dad? That's one of the questions that the children want to know, whether the father loves them. And number four, they want to know, when are you coming home, Dad?
My goodness.
You know, these four questions are lingering and, you know, they're carrying this every single day in their shoulders when they go to school. So the first thing that we do in Proverbs 2-6 is engage the fathers with their children so that the fathers can tell their children, I love you.
Okay.
Fathers can tell their children, you know, whatever I have done, I'm sorry for it.
Yeah.
You know, and then the second part is like, you know, we take these children through a mentoring program and that's encouraging these children to stay inside the school. What we found is like one out of eight kids that goes to elementary school drops out before finishing high school.
Yeah.
You know, that's 6.6 million children that are dropping out of school every single year. Out of 6.6 million that are dropping out of school every single year, 1.6 million children are ending up in prison every single year in this country.
That's incredible.
You know, so we wanted to mentor and give these children a father figure who can go into their lives and tell them the coolest thing is not going into prison. The coolest thing is staying out of prison.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And then we help them with the education process. Mm-hmm. You know, we have educational mentors that are helping them. And then we enable them to go to college and we pay for their college. We have our first kid out of the 650 kid that's going to college this fall in Croker University.
Wow, that's awesome, man. That's awesome. Listen, let's talk a little bit about the back to school program.
Yes.
Because the back to school program that you did was very unique.
Correct.
And I know it was the first time that I know of, and I've been doing prison ministry for 17 years, I've ever heard
yes.
of anything like that. Tell us a little bit about the back to school program at Kershaw Prison in South Carolina.
Last year, during a July timeframe, we took about $16,000 worth of school supplies, and we turned that prison into Walmart. We allowed the fathers to come through the line and buy the stuff for free and put it into a bag. And before they send the bag to their children, we ask the fathers to answer those four questions as a blessing to that child.
Wow.
And we took that bag in the name of the Father, went to their houses, and gave it to their children in the name of the Father.
Wow. So now you're talking about empowering of the man.
Yes.
The inmate now has a sense of worth.
Absolutely.
A sense of value.
Absolutely.
And now he's a provider.
Correct.
For his own children.
Correct.
Wow.
The children needs to know the father who is inside the prison still loves me.
Cyril, I have to ask you the hard question.
Yes.
In your ministry, when you're doing your outreach, is it important for you to communicate to the inmate, to the man in the prison, that he's still the head of his household, he's still the father, and that no amount of time that he's away should that diminish? Do you
Absolutely.
Communicate that to him?
Absolutely.
Tell us how they receive that.
Oh, I tell the fathers all the time that, you know, they being the father for that child is very critical.
Yeah.
Because I find, you know, children that are still holding on to the bears that these fathers bought for them 8 years ago.
Right.
The children are still wearing the dresses that the father gave it to them 12 years ago.
Yeah.
These children are trying to smell the coat of the father to
yes.
smell him.
Yes.
You know? So the kid hasn't lost that love for that father.
Right.
I ask these children most of the time, you know, what do you want to become? And the common answer that I get is like they want to be a lawyer
mm-hmm.
because they know the lawyers can save their father.
Right.
And they want to save their father.
That's amazing.
The father has to feel it.
Right. It's funny you mention that because one of the young men that we were, the son of one of the men that we're ministering to in the Mandate Project in Kershaw, he's never seen his dad.
Absolutely.
His father's been in for 14 years. He went in 4 years, you know, his father was born, I mean, before the young man was born. And we were talking, and he was out there with a football, and he's out there moving around, This is the way my daddy does this, and this is the way my daddy did this. And I was thinking that he'd never even seen his father.
Correct.
So what I'm saying is that I want, because you've been emphasizing in Proverbs 22:6 is that the father factor.
Absolutely.
I want to talk, we're going to get to this at the end of the show, but I want you to talk about this right now because I'm just feeling the spirit about this thing.
Absolutely.
The presence of the father. Let's talk about what the prison industrial complex represents as a corporation mm-hmm. and the lie that's being perpetrated. This is just an African-American issue.
Right.
Let's talk about that.
Right. Because, you know, oftentimes, you know, people think this is an African-American issue. You know why? Because one out of three African-American men are in prison
yeah.
in major urban cities,
yeah.
right? And they also know the number that every African-American child, any African-American child that does not finish the high school will go to prison before the age 30. This is a statistic. This is a proven statistic.
Mm-hmm.
So they always thought this is an African-American issue. No. In the Hispanic community, 8 out of 10 moms who are giving birth today are single moms.
Right.
Okay? The problem is not African-American issue. This is not an Hispanic issue. It's because we don't have fathers at home.
Yes.
85% of the men that are serving time today in prison grew up in a fatherless home. And we are creating another 82% of them to go back into the prison. We have 2.3 million children, million men that are serving time in prison today. 2.3 million.
Yes.
We have 7.2 million men and women that are either serving time or monitored by the system. A country called Israel only has 5 million people. We have a nation full of people that is inside the prison. And the statistics says that, you know, every inmate has 1.5 children. That means we have over 10 million children, out of which 82% are coming into this prison cells.
Right.
Right? And so the government knows this number. The research has been proven again and again. Last year alone, we spent $74 billion
yes.
in keeping this industry alive.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So we know.
So it's big business.
Absolutely.
So it's not really about rehabilitating people.
No.
Because really, how can you rehabilitate somebody that hadn't habilitated in the first place?
Absolutely.
It's all about dollars and cents, isn't it?
Absolutely.
So let's talk, since you said that, you brought it up, let's talk about CCA.
Yes.
And tell us a little bit about that company and what they represent as it relates to the prison industrial complex.
So there are a lot of companies that are building prisons in this country. One of them is, you know, Corrections Corporations of America, okay? And this company builds prisons, right? And what they are doing. It's a mutual funds company. I mean, you can actually invest on these companies that are building more prisons in this country, wow. Right? And this country, last week, I saw an article in New York Times that they are going to build more prisons, and IRS is giving a tax break for these companies.
Don't move too fast, Harold. Okay. So you're saying, I want you to slow down and say that again.
Yes.
That the IRS
is giving a tax break for these companies because they are projecting that Corrections Corporations of America is renting a place for inmates at a subsidized price. And so they can build more prisons and give a subsidized price for these inmates in prison.
Wow. Okay, so now that's demonic to me. I mean, that's heinous. Listen, listen, all of the rules are off the table now. Because now we're talking about the total degradation of entire humanity.
Absolutely.
This is not a racial issue.
Absolutely
and
not.
And that's the deception, isn't it?
Correct. It's an epidemic. Yes. It's an epidemic that America faces without having fathers at home.
We can almost literally put the United States on trial at The Hague for crimes against humanity.
Absolutely.
That too high for you?
No.
Okay, all right. How about this? The kids that you're serving, how many kids are in your program?
650 kids.
Okay, tell us about the kids in your program.
Right now, we have kids that are in 4 different cities in South Carolina and 1 city in North Carolina, in Charlotte, okay. Right? And we go into the lives of these children and help them every single day. You know, I've seen a lot of programs that are out there. There are a lot of prison ministries out there. There are a lot of nonprofits that are working either with the kids that are outside or with the inmates that are inside.
Right.
What we are trying to do is like a merge these two together. Why? Because when the father gets out of the prison, they don't know, you know, how to behave with that child.
Exactly.
When they went into the prison, the child was 3 years old. Right. When they get out of the prison after 10 years, the child's 13, but the father behaves like the child's 3 years old.
Yes.
We need to break that cycle by introducing the child back into the life of these children.
Right.
I mean, the second thing is these children also needs to hear from their father.
Yes.
That this father who is serving time still loves them.
That's so important because another thing that we talk about in our things is that because we've got long-term offenders that we're dealing with as well, and children communicate differently.
Absolutely.
So these millennial kids are all digital.
Correct.
We're old school. You know,
Correct.
You know,
Correct.
We are having the hair left. We're still dealing with the old school approach. So we have to be
Correct.
Digital and forward thinking in terms of, you know, how we deal with what's needed most for you? If you could say, Nick, these are the things we need most, what does Proverbs 2:26 need most?
Right now, I see that, you know, these children are growing without fathers.
Right.
And what we need is until the father comes home, for example, like there is a man who is serving time in this prison, cannot even see their children because he has a restriction till 2026. For the next 13 years, this father cannot see his children, his wife, his mama, his father.
Right.
Okay? So that means like we need to have somebody to step into the role of the father to tell the kid for the next 13 years, this is the right thing to do and this is the wrong thing to do. And so what I need right now is like we have 650 kids. I need mentors in Columbia. I need mentors in Charleston. I need mentors in Myrtle Beach. I need mentors in Greenville.
Wow.
And I need mentors in Charlotte.
Wow. You know, it's very interesting. And for the point, we're going to take a point. We're going to roll to the video right now. And the video we want to talk about is the video that related to the back-to-school program.
Absolutely.
All right.
Thank you.
Jay hasn't seen his kids in almost 5 years.
We're considered society's garbage, you know, the throwaways. But for most of us, there's still someone out there that calls us daddy.
We need to first stop thinking that these guys as inmates.
Cyril Prabhu is the founder of Proverbs 2:26. He focuses on mending relationships between fathers locked up at the Kershaw Correctional Institution and their children.
The children need to hear the fact that you love them, that you care for them, that you need a second chance in their life.
If the kids get good grades, the program helps them get into college.
We will work with these children, help them with the education, take them through college,
and pay for their college.
One incarcerated father already feels the benefits.
Individual squad, right face.
Derek Sarge leads one of the prison drill teams.
My little boy is doing great. He's actually really involved in this, in the 226 program. He's a straight A student. He just won a national award for an art contest.
Sarge says with help, he's learning to be a parent behind bars.
I think it's hard. Sometimes I feel like my children think that I let them down, and some they have a little resentment to me, but at the same time, they still know that I'm daddy.
Chaplain Gerald Patoka says he doesn't know of any other organization that helps inmates and their families.
It has a major effect on giving men in this place a hope for their children that they won't follow their footsteps.
4,365 children are arrested daily. 1.6 million end up in prison every single year. Proverbs 2:26 hopes to finally put a stop to the cycle. Jacinda Garabito, Fox News.
Wow, man, listen, you have to be dead to miss that. Man, just, you know, I just applaud you for the ministry and for what you're doing. But I want to ask you one real question. How many children are you committed to help through this program?
650 children right now.
And does it matter where they want to go to school?
No, it doesn't.
If it's an Ivy League school, if it's a junior college, it doesn't
matter? No, it doesn't matter.
Are you trying to tell me if a kid wanted to go to Cornell or Princeton, or if he wanted to go to Cal Berkeley, you'd take care of that?
Correct. Why? Because, you know, we go into their lives early in their cycle, and we actually make sure that these kids get, like, a good grades. Because every single program that they need to participate, they need to have grades average, C average or better. Mm. So that means the kids are already tamed to get better grades.
Wow.
For them to get the scholarship. So there is an ultimate motive for them to do good at school.
So you need mentors. You need people to step to the plate to nurture these kids and usher these kids in. You got different institutions you're looking at for support.
Correct.
Here's the question for me. Once you've captured these children and you've got the support you need and you're walking alongside of them, how does the father in prison interact with the mentor? Or is that the possibility for
Absolutely, because the mentors who are serving in the role of the father for that child will go back into the prison, talk to the fathers.
Wow.
Let the fathers know how well they are doing at school. Let the fathers know how much they love this man who is inside the prison.
My goodness. And I think really what I really see from the engagement that's going on inside the prison from the clip that we just saw, that you've got the support of the administration, because I do know for a fact that even the warden is 100,000% behind what you're doing.
Absolutely, because she sees there is a change in these men's life. Even though we are working with the children outside and their families outside, the men hear about what is going outside and they are cleaning themselves inside from making mistakes. And that's what is a positive thing for the prison.
So what do we say to the communities that receive these young men that's coming back from both South Carolina to North Carolina and vice versa? What do we say to the communities, to the churches, to the employers? What do we say about giving these men a second chance to engage and to become gainfully employed and provide for their families? What do we say to them?
Absolutely. I mean, these men have already proved themselves to clean themselves and haven't committed any additional things to cause them to stay behind the bars.
Right.
They're coming out and saying, I want to be a father to my child.
Wow.
They need to give a second chance.
They need to give them a second chance. And then can you think of any types of engagements where somebody that's sitting here watching right now on television, they say, Cyril, look, I want to get involved. You know, how can I get involved? How do I get connected? Can I get connected to Proverbs 22?
Absolutely. You know, we have, they can reach us through proverbs226.org. That's the website. Mm-hmm. And they can go to facebook.com/proverbs226.
Okay.
Those are two ways that they can connect with us, and we will be more than happy to take them through this process, train them to be the mentors, train them to be the educational mentors, and put them through a child who can just get benefited by the good-hearted people.
So you can be reached by the internet.
Yes.
You can be reached on Facebook.
Absolutely.
And then you have a comprehensive training program.
Correct.
That partners them with kids. Correct. Who have a desire to become scholars and athletes and doctors and lawyers, and more importantly, to be children to their fathers and the fathers to be dads to the children.
Right. The Bible says, like, you know, after 400 years of being silent, God comes around and says, you know, I will turn the hearts of these children towards their fathers, and I will turn the hearts of the fathers towards their children.
Yes.
Lest I will come and strike this earth with a curse.
Right.
Proverbs 2-6 is a conduit that's going to make the fathers to turn their hearts towards their children and the hearts of the children towards their fathers.
So we'll make the statement to a man, don't take it lightly that God made you a man.
No.
Number one.
Correct.
And number two, for the child, never forsake your father.
No.
Okay, with the last minute or so we have left, I want you to take 30 seconds and I want you to give me your closing remark and the statement that you would make to whomever is listening.
My Bible says, you know, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and seek my face and turn from their wickedness, I will hear them from heaven. I will forgive their sins and I will heal their nation. Today, this country needs healing.
Yes.
This country needs healing more than ever. You know, these children need healing. And my Father in heaven says, I will do it for you. And I'm asking, you know, whoever is watching today,
yes,
to becoming one of the healer for one of these children.
Wow. The composite of, this ministry taking place in a very peculiar place.
Yes.
But yet a place that would seem to fit the ministry of reconciliation.
Correct.
And healing and deliverance. And that happens by engaging and empowering the men.
Correct.
To become effective ministers even in their own household.
Correct.
And by reaching out to the community to become more receptive to the hearts of the men and giving them an opportunity to serve. So I want to ask one final question in a really brief answer. What do you take away from this? Tonight, I want to thank you so much. We have to make sure that you get this this candy, because as a lover of everything chocolate, I'd be remiss without saying welcome to the chocolate box.
Thank you.
Brother, we want to thank you so much for coming tonight. We want to thank the Chocolate Drop for allowing us to be hosts, and we thank you for this edition of the Chocolate Box Presents. I'm your host, Nick Moore. Brother Cyril Prabhu, we thank you so much, and we look forward to getting to see you again.